L'agenda 2030, un agenda
Agenda
pour la
2030 is an agenda for the youth. Yes, because youth is possibly its main beneficiary. But overall, because Agenda 2030 is an agenda made by the youth. Why? Because young people are already the actors playing in it. For instance, youth in France is committed and mobilized, notably through associations. One young person out of five in France is a member of an association, not necessarily in connection with the environment, but committed to serve general interest and collaboration. In spite of the fact that environmental NGOs are underrepresented in the field of environment protection, 30% of our young people have a pretty good idea of what is sustainable development. Yet more than half have had access to the term, but only half. Why does only a share of them, and a small one for that matter, understand or perceive SDGs as a tool, maybe a way to act? Why is that? One may question the relevance of the means employed to disseminate information or provide access to information. Who do we talk to? How do we talk about it? Do we need to renew the language in order to talk to the younger generations of today's world? They would like to become the owners of SDGs, but before they do that, they must have access to them, understand them, talk about them. What do they mean by SDGs? What do they expect from SDGs? First, they must gain an across-the-board understanding of the challenges, modern challenges, seen like a whole group of challenges. How? By mobilizing all the players in civil society, governmental players, local and global players. How do we move together in order to meet the goals which nowadays constitute an international roadmap? We are fully aware of this. For us, the main challenge with regard to SDGs is to turn them into something concrete, to go into action. Although it has only partially embraced SDGs, our youth has already gone into action. Sometimes the projects, the initiatives do not exactly meet the SDGs because they were not catalogued as such. However, they address the issues, sometimes only one, sometimes more than one, and they already plan on binding them all together. It's an entry point. Education for the youth, climate change, a topic which is extensively debated, increasingly so. And for us, it's the entry point to view things in a more systemic way. Once we have access to information, we can turn it into a performance tool, efficient, something to help mobilize people. And we systematically strive to move from building awareness to increasing mobilization. So we take the info, we absorb it. We upgrade our capacities in order to be in a position to transfer the information to other young people, but also to encourage them to act. What does it mean in concrete terms? It means we don't satisfy ourselves simply with a top-down lesson coming from a trainer for a student, but rather we want to reverse the roles, to turn the lesson into an interactive event where people participate and buy into the ideas, become their owners. One example from the Climates Association, the COP in My City project. The idea is to organize simulations of international negotiations on climate, a rather opaque subject, which they try to make more accessible. How? Well, of course, by disclosing information, by making it easier to grasp what is it, how to take part. How do the climate-related negotiations include all of the SDGs? But it's also an interacting, participatory event, a role play. It's the kind of method that may be exported to discuss, debate on complex topics. And then there is the third phase, mobilization, where a bridge is built between the initial shared moments, students to students and teachers, and the time when we all become players in change. The mobilization happens on the local level. With a single project, we move from the global level, negotiations on climate, to the local level. What can we do at home? How? With whom? We move from international diplomacy to local public politics. We become the players, we participate in our city's life, and this contributes to a more fulfilling life as youngster, as player, in the society we belong to. What does this change mean? What does this commitment mean for young people? We act as drivers in the commitment towards individual transition, an ecological transition which should happen not only on the global and regional level, but also on the individual level. We change our lifestyles, we encourage our friends and relatives to change their own lifestyle along with us through association action, but also by moderating the social debate. There's the political debate, there is the debate between players in civil society, and there is the debate between the youth and all the people they meet, our families, and how to change things on our own small scale and how to connect the changes achieved with the local scale, individual and collective. A way to reunite them could well be just to use the SDGs and serve the SDGs. For the youth, there could be three major advantages in SDGs. The first would consist in using them like a roadmap. How, based on SDGs, can one create a framework to assess, catalogue and connect our initiatives between them? Does this project meet SDG 4 on youth? Does it address SDG 13 on the fight against climate change? Maybe both at the same time. And often, not only two, but even three or four SDGs at the same time. How do we act from a roadmap? This is the first advantage. The second consists in viewing SDGs as potential tools for advocacy. Why advocacy? Because for the first time, on top of wishing all countries to attain the common goals on the UN level, we have steered the objectives towards the sustainability of the initiatives we plan to pursue together. So how does youth potentially climb on board to accelerate things, to move everything forward, further, faster, and together? A third advantage, legitimation of what this may bring. How can youth, through the SDGs, by gaining ownership, become a more legitimate player in the eyes of the other players of society, governmental and non-governmental alike? This issue is one that youth has often come up against, here and there. How do we become more credible for political and social initiatives? In fact, it has become a challenge. We try to renew the way we address the subjects, to form partnerships, to collaborate, because often enough, youth is facing a lack of consideration as a player of youth-driven initiatives. For example, look at the framework provided by SDGs. There is no SDG regarding youth. What does it mean? Does it mean that youth is left aside in the international framework, or is it considered as a full-fledged player, in which case it is supposed to assess and implement all the SDGs? Yes, but then who listens? Who listens and acknowledges our projects, our initiatives? As a matter of fact, youth already holds the knowledge, the methods it uses to pursue the SDGs, without necessarily listing them as SDG projects. We're talking about informal information and projects rather bottom-up. But why? Because they fill a gap. Because today we do not talk, or not enough, about sustainable development, climate change, biodiversity in our schools, in the street, not even in the political debate. We have developed those tools, ways to go from increasing awareness to mobilizing people, but we're not always being heard by anyone. These tools have not yet been acknowledged. We need to weigh the youth is perceived, sometimes by youth itself, how we are viewed, how we view ourselves, how we promote ourselves, and how we come up with initiatives and find our way into the decision-making process. The key for youth is to sit at the negotiation table, to make itself heard, And our voices are already connected. They are international. They are transversal. We know what to say together. There's no debate, no issue around the solutions we want to carry forward together because we share the same orientation. Our generation was born in a more or less stable political environment, but objectives had already been set for us, potentially common, as well as potentially common issues in a world that already was seen as globalized. So we bought into it very early. We're connected with the negotiations on climate. Observers have come together in a youth group. We're present. We speak out on the local level as well. How to include young people in the decision-making process? By valuing again and again their commitment, by changing how youth is perceived, by making it more legitimate, credible, so that it may get a chance to discuss, create, and innovate. These changes in perception, this inclusion, should pave the way for a more consistent framework, overarching all SDGs, all players. For the younger generations, SDGs are taken for granted. We were simply born with them, although they were not there yet. Once we get there, young people are those who will make it last, who will fulfill Agenda 2030 and beyond. It's obvious, and it's precisely the reason why Agenda 2030 must be an agenda for the youth, but first and foremost, an agenda by the youth.
Un agenda par la jeunesse.